Hi, I'm John, and welcome to part 4 of this IT Taster video series on IPv4 addressing. In this video, we'll take a look at subnetting. We'll begin with what subnetting is, go through some basic subnetting techniques, and finish off by examining variable length subnetting. Subnetting is a technique used to divide a network address into smaller networks. These smaller networks, or subnetworks, are known as subnets. There are a number of important reasons why it's necessary to divide a network into smaller subnets. One of the most important ones is that subnetting enables us to make more efficient use of an IP address space. Large numbers of host devices on a single flat network generate more broadcast traffic, which affects performance. Breaking down the single flat network and single broadcast domain into smaller subnets and smaller broadcast domains contains broadcasts and makes the overall performance more efficient. We're also able to add a layer of security to a network by dividing it into subnets. Access controls can be added to filter traffic between networks. For example, we may only want to allow specific departments to communicate with each other, or even specific hosts. Organizations with multiple sites spread over different geographical locations still need their IT systems to be able to communicate. By dividing an IP network into subnets, each site can be assigned its own subnet. Routers are then able to route network traffic between the different sites. Now that we know the most common reasons for subnetting, let's now take a look at how subnetting works. Subnetting involves taking an IP network and altering its subnet mask. Host bits are borrowed or traded to become network bits. The network ID is extended and the host ID is reduced. By extending the network ID, additional networks, subnetworks, are created. So we gain more networks, i.e. subnets, but the number of possible hosts is reduced. In order to show you the basic techniques involved in subnetting, I'm going to walk you through a simple example, and I'm going to use the network address 192.168.0.0 with a 24-bit subnet mask, 255.255.255.0, which will allow me to keep the numbers small and easy to work with. I'm also going to display the network address and subnet mask in binary to enable you to see what's really going on at grassroots level. When the subnet mask is applied, we can see we have 24 network bits and 8 host bits. 8 host bits gives a total of 256 addresses, including the network and broadcast addresses. Subnetting enables us to divide a network address into subnets by altering the subnet mask. In order to create more networks, subnets, we need to borrow from the host ID portion. This is done by setting host bits to 1 instead of 0. To make them network bits. I'm going to alter the subnet mask accordingly and set 2 of the host bits to 1 to create new subnets. But notice the number of host bits is reduced. Also note that the subnet mask has changed from 24 bits to 26 bits, 255.255.255.192 in dotted decimal notation. This is the new subnet mask that must be applied to our new subnets. So how many subnets have we created in this example? To determine the number of subnets, we need to raise 2 to the power of the number of new network bits borrowed from the host ID. In this example, 2. 2 to the power of 2 equals 4, which gives us 4 subnets. We can also see this if we count upwards in binary using 2 bits, 00, 01, 10, and 1.1, which again gives us 4 subnets. We also need to know the number of hosts per subnet. To do this, we need to raise 2 to the power of the number of host bits, which in this example is 2 to the power of 6, which equals 64. But don't forget, we must subtract 2 from this figure to allow for the network address and broadcast address, which leaves us with 62 hosts per subnet. So we have 4 subnets and 62 hosts per subnet. Now that we've worked out the number of subnets and the number of hosts, there are some important addresses we need to establish. The first thing I'm going to do is determine the network address of each of the 4 subnets. And this is done by examining the first 2 bits of the 4th octet, the 2 bits we borrowed from the host ID to create our subnets, and then convert them to dotted decimal notation. If we transfer the octet to a binary table and add the values of the first 2 bits, 0 plus 0 equals 0. The network address of the first subnet is 192.168.0.0. If we repeat the process for the second subnet, transfer the octet to the binary table and add the values of the first 2 bits, 0 plus 64 equals 64. The network address of the second subnet in dotted decimal notation is 192.168.0.64. And we're also able to establish that the network addresses are incrementing by 64. We need to do the same for the third subnet. Transfer the octet to the binary table and add the values of the first 2 bits. 128 plus 0 equals 128. The network address of the third subnet in dotted decimal notation is 192.168.0.128. And finally, the fourth subnet. If we transfer the octet to the binary table and add the values of the first 2 bits together, or simply increment the previous network address by 64, we arrive at the value of 192. The network address of the fourth subnet is 192.168.0.192. Now that we've established the network address of each subnet, the next thing I'm going to do is determine the broadcast address of each subnet. We learned earlier in the video series that an IP address with all of the host bits set to 1 is the broadcast address. So to determine the broadcast address for each of the 4 subnets, I'm going to set all of the host bits to 1 for each subnet. If the 6 host bits are transferred to a binary table and the values are added, we arrive at the decimal value of 63. If we transfer all 8 bits of the 4th octet for each subnet to the binary table, we can calculate their broadcast addresses. Let's begin with the first subnet. 0 plus 63 equals 63. The broadcast address for the first subnet is 192.168.0.63. The second subnet, 0 plus 64 plus 63, equals 127. So the broadcast address for the second subnet is 192.168.0.127. For the third subnet, 128 plus 0 plus 63 equals 191. The broadcast address for the third subnet is 192.168.0.191. And finally, the fourth subnet, 128 plus 64 plus 63 equals 255. The broadcast address for the fourth subnet is 192.168.0.255. Notice that the broadcast address is the last address before the next network address. Okay, now that we've calculated the network address and broadcast address for each of the four subnets, it's very straightforward to work out the host addresses for each subnet. All we need to do is fill in the addresses in between the network and broadcast address for each subnet. So for the first subnet, host addresses begin with 192.168.0.1 and end at 192.168.0.62. For the second subnet, host addresses begin with 192.168.0.65 and end at 192.168.0.126. For the third subnet, host addresses begin with 192.168.0.129 and end at 192.168.0.190. And for the fourth subnet, host addresses begin with 192.168.0.193 and end at 192.168.0.254. We now have the network address, broadcast address and host addresses for each of the four subnets. In the example, we took a small network, 192.168.0.0/24, with 254 valid host addresses, and divided it into four equal subnets by borrowing two host bits to increase the total number of network bits to 26 bits. This gave us four new subnets with 62 hosts per subnet. This method is known as basic subnetting, and it's ideal for smaller networks, but it does lack the flexibility needed when working with larger and more complex networks. It's less efficient and can result in wasted addresses. So for larger networks with more complex requirements, another type of subnetting technique often used is variable length subnetting. Variable length subnetting is much more flexible. It uses variable length subnet masks to make more efficient use of an address space. This enables us to divide an address space more efficiently and better fit an organization's requirements. Variable length subnetting uses many of the subnetting techniques we've already covered. We simply need to adopt a slightly different process. In this example, we have three sites. Site A requires 100 host addresses, Site B requires 40 host addresses, and Site C requires 20 host addresses. I'm going to work with the network 192.168.0.0/24 again to keep things nice and simple. We know the network 192.168.0.0/24 gives us 254 valid hosts to work with after allowing for the network address and broadcast address. So we begin with the largest address requirement first, 100 hosts for site A. If we subnet the network 192.168.0.0/24 by borrowing one host bit, the subnet mask is adjusted to 25 bits, /25. This creates two subnets, 192.168.0.0/25 and 192.168.0.128/25, with 126 valid hosts per subnet after allowing for the network address and broadcast address of each subnet. So we assign the first subnet, 192.168.0.0/25, to site A. 126 valid hosts will accommodate site A's requirement of 100 hosts. The second subnet, 192.168.0.128/25, is put to one side for the next step in the process. The next step is to work out the subnet for the second largest address requirement, Site B, which requires 40 hosts. So we take the subnet 192.168.0.128/25 that we set aside previously. We know that the network 192.168.0.128/25 gives us 126 valid hosts to work with after allowing for the network address and broadcast address. If we subnet the network 192.168.0.128/25 by borrowing one host bit, the subnet mask is adjusted to 26 bits, /26. This creates two subnets, 192.168.0.128/26 and 192.168.0.192/26, with 62 valid hosts per subnet, after allowing for the network address and broadcast address of each subnet. So we assign the first subnet 192.168.0.128/26 to site B. 62 valid hosts will accommodate site B's requirement of 40 hosts. The second subnet 192.168.0.192/26 is put to one side for the next step in the process. And finally, we're left with site C, which requires 20 hosts. So we take the second subnet 192.168.0.192/26 that we set aside previously. We know that the network 192.168.0.192/26 gives us 62 valid hosts to work with after allowing for the network address and broadcast address. If we subnet the network 192.168.0.192/26 by borrowing one host bit, the subnet mask is adjusted to 27 bits, /27. This creates two subnets, 192.168.0.192/27 and 192.168.0.224/27, with 30 valid hosts per subnet after allowing for the network address and broadcast address of each subnet. So we assign the first subnet 192.168.0.192/27 to site C. 30 valid hosts will accommodate site C's requirement of 20 hosts. The second subnet 192.168.0.224/27 is put to one side, and it's effectively a spare subnet that we may wish to use in the future. We've used variable length subnetting to carve up the IP address space 192.168.0.0/24. We've made more efficient use of the address space. It meets the needs of each site in the example, and we also have spare addresses for future use. This, of course, is a simple example, but as with many aspects of IT, when it comes to variable length subnetting, taking the time to plan carefully is essential. Well, that brings us to the end of the video and also to the end of the IP version 4 addressing series. I hope you found all of the videos helpful. Don't forget, please subscribe to the IT Taster channel if you haven't already. Your comments are welcome, and thanks for watching.